So as Dr. Billings mentioned, I'm going to give two pretty different speeches, but that one is the setup for why I started this organization, and the second part is telling you about it. And then I would love to open it up for Q&A, because as he mentioned, I have a ton of experience in probably an industry that you're pretty interested in, and so hopefully we can kind of go back and forth, and I can tell you what I know and what you want to find out. Does that work for everybody? Okay. So the first 10 minutes of this is going to be my TED speech for tomorrow, and then I'll move on into more about Culture Relay. The tattoo on my wrist says Gypsy, and it's appropriate because I'm a traveler. I've been to 67 countries, and I've lived abroad for 10 years. My mom's name is actually Gypsy. That's why it's on my wrist. And she worked two jobs when I was little, so she was always on the go. And my dad, who's here, he moved to Florida when I was 6. So I grew up always wanting to travel to see him. We didn't have the means to travel everywhere, but I saw the world through the characters in books. So I would sneak them into my magical butterfly sleeping bag at night, and I'd read books like The Jungle Book. And I fell in love with a long-haired Indian boy called Mowgli, and I wanted to be just like his girlfriend, Shanti. So as I would play with my neighbors in the Valley Avenue apartments in Birmingham, Manju and Madhu Curry, I'd ask them questions like, why does your mom have a dot in the middle of her forehead? I didn't know, and I was a kid, I asked these questions. And they said, it's where her soul enters and leaves her body. So this was fascinating. It tied Shanti from a book to a real character. My teachers also helped. I'm gonna age myself here, but in 1985, it was the height of the Cold War. And I would remember hearing on the news all about impending World War III, and I should be terrified of Russia. And I was scared this would end my young life. And so my teacher decided that we fear what we don't know and what we don't understand. So she threw away our curriculum for the year. I mean, this is a public high school or public elementary school in Birmingham, Alabama. She threw it away, and she spent a year teaching us all about Russian culture, arts, history, music, and language. And this helped me understand how much more similar we are around the world than we might believe. And so as I read all of Tolstoy when I lived in Russia years and years later, it helped connect me back to that time, and it really makes it important for me to share that today. When I was a senior in college, I went to Wake Forest, and my teachers planned a trip to go to Europe for 6 weeks. I didn't have a dime, because I worked my whole way through college to pay for it. And I didn't have a passport either, but I knew I had to go. So I called a bank account, or called a credit card company, and I borrowed $5,000 at 24% interest. Now listen, as a head of finance now, I would say just never do that, it's too much, it's just too expensive. But it changed my life, and so I went anyway. And then at 24, I got this crazy chance working for Kodak in Atlanta to move to Paris for 6 months. So I jumped at it. And I kept jumping for the next 9 years. I lived in Paris, Amsterdam, Germany, Hong Kong, London, Dubai, South Africa, and Russia. And if you think that's exhausting listening to those places, I can tell you it was exhausting moving that many times. But I lived in all the places I read about as a little girl. And then somewhere in my early 30s, I listened to reason. I settled down in London in one job as a management consultant with one person, and I tried really hard to stifle my inner gypsy. It didn't feel right, but it felt required. So today, as you have all of your lives in front of you, don't do what you feel is required. Then one Monday morning in October 2005, I woke up. I landed in Amsterdam on my weekly commute from London, and it was a beautiful blue sky day, just like this kind of day today. And that's pretty unusual for Amsterdam, and also for London, for that matter. So as I landed there, I remembered a perfect golf day where I had played 2 weeks before with my darling and dear friend Leslie. So I landed, and I sent her a text, and I let her know I was thinking about her. And this is in the days of text when it was kind of, you had to press multiple times on one letter to get all the letters out, so it took a while. And so it's 2005. And so I sent her this text message, and I went on with my day, and I forgot about it. And a couple hours later, I got a text back from her number, and it said simply, she's gone. Well, gone where? I thought. I had just seen her, and I had just talked to her on Friday. And that's when I called her boyfriend, And he let me know that she had died the night before. And she'd had a heart attack, and she was 29. Totally unexpectedly. This was obviously devastating. And in order to deal with that kind of devastation, I had to numb myself and numb my feelings in order to just survive it. And the thing about numbing grief is it works well about grief, but horribly for happiness. And that led to the slow death of another very important relationship in my life when I realized I had been numb for a very long time. I longed to feel anything at all. And so I decided to jumpstart my heart through fear, the primal kind. So fear is a funny thing. I will travel anywhere in the world by myself, but I can't stand on top of that chair to put the star on top of the Christmas tree because I am deathly afraid of heights. So as I went to Victoria Falls in Zambia, I watched at the second highest bungee jump in the world for 8 hours with people going off that ledge. Now, being really terrified of heights, this actually really made me mortally afraid. But I decided to listen to my friend who had told me there were two kinds of people that go to Vic Falls, those who jump and those who don't. And my pride made me get in line for this thing. So I scooted my way to the edge of the platform, and I stood up on shaky legs, clinging to the man behind me. And I took a deep breath while he wrapped, I promise you, it looked like a towel around my feet. And it was about 7 times the height of the Vulcan statue in Birmingham, probably nearly the height of the Empire State Building, a pretty tall, tall bridge. Took a deep breath, and I jumped. The pictures would say and show that I did not jump, and I was absolutely pushed off the ledge. And that's how it felt. So I was so afraid I couldn't even make a sound on the way down. But the good news is I survived. I'm here talking to you today, so it didn't go that badly. But I do think that that going off that ledge was important for me. And I want you now to close your eyes. Everybody, close them. And I want you to think about something that really terrifies you. Maybe it's something physical. Maybe it's something emotional. And maybe just asking the question is a scary thing. So I want you to picture it and crystallize it, because we'll come back to it. Okay, you can open them back up. See, the thing about facing your fears head first is that it stimulates growth. And as an introvert, which I am, traveling and moving around the world was terrifying, but it absolutely pushed me to be who I am today. And so through this journey, I have 3 things that I wanted to share with you today and 3 lessons I've learned. The first is to travel light. As I landed in Egypt in 2007, I drove with some friends from Cairo to Alexandria, down the Sinai Peninsula to Sharm el-Sheikh, which is the best scuba diving in the world, in the Red Sea. Along the way, we stopped in the Sinai Desert. And we stopped for a couple days to ride camels with the Bedouins. Now, I don't know if you know Bedouins, but Bedouins are nomads or wanderers, a lot like gypsies. They travel light and they leave everything that's heavy behind. And so as they go through life, you know, they don't have big bank accounts or fancy cars or even the latest technology, and they're certainly not tweeting when they're out in the desert, but they have, for me, what is a richness, because they have diamonds in their stars every night in the desert. And we're not all going to go be Bedouins in deserts, but I think it's important to realize that in the race, especially in this country, to acquire things, that it bogs us down. And so I've learned in life that the lighter my backpack, the more freedom I have. So travel light and get rid of the non-essential. The second story I have is about choosing what to see. So I landed in Koh Samui, which is a small island off the coast of Thailand. If you guys remember seeing The Beach, the movie, it's a lot like that island. And I stepped off, it's my first night dive ever, night scuba dive, stepped off the boat, and I descended 80 feet into dark, cold, murky water. Now it was so dark that I couldn't even see my hand, even if I put it on my nose. And so this is when having a big imagination is a bad thing, because I could imagine huge, massive sharks. I grew up in Florida partially with my dad, so of course Jaws plays into my fears. But I also could have had a rare and beautiful fish that I would have seen. And the thing is, the only thing I could see is what I turned my flashlight on. And so it reminded me that through life, we, as we go through it, we're able to see what we choose to see. And that includes the bad, the good, the terrifying, and the beautiful. So know that you have the power to bring what you will into focus. The third lesson that I learned is to take the detours. This comes from a story in Vietnam when I traveled from Hanoi in the north to Ho Chi Minh City in the south. It's about 720 miles, a two-hour flight, or a 19-hour bus ride. And we decided to take the bus on the way down. We did this because we were able to stop at so many little villages along the way. And actually one of them, called Hoi An, is one of my favorites of all my trips I've ever been to. And I would have totally missed it had I only been concentrated on the final destination. See, the good stuff lies in the detours. The destination that we imagine is so much more limited than the possibilities presented by detours. So that's what I'm going to talk about with you today, is my own personal detour. So as Andy mentioned, after 18 years of working in corporate America, last year I decided to jump off into my own unknown. And I started something called Culture Relay. And the purpose of that is to connect girls around the world and let them know that they're so much more similar than they might believe. And so if we can use sport as something that really is a common platform, then we're able to explore our differences in a safe way. And so that's Culture Relay. And that's it for my TED Talk. And now I'll move on to Culture Relay itself. Where it came from is really, you know, I had to go back to thinking about adolescence. And I see a lot of you guys, you're barely out of adolescence. So you probably feel a lot older than that, but trust me, at 40, you aren't. You're much closer. And I began connecting with some old high school friends. And it's funny because I felt like I was one of the only people that was always playing sports, usually alone, and usually had my nose in a book. But it turns out quite a few people, particularly girls, were busy sitting in hallways and trying to get their homework done because they needed to do something after school. And also, frankly, because we didn't want to face the rejection of trying to find out who to sit with at the lunchroom table. I'm not sure if anyone here, if that's a common story, but I've been interested to know that that's more common than you might think. And so it was at 14 that kind of a chaotic period of life started for me. First, my mom got injured, and as she did, my grandparents moved in to take care of her, and my stepdad moved out. The second thing is that my natural shyness and introversion really made me a target for mean girls. And the third is that my high school coach started doing body fat analysis on us just to see, it's called calipers, as you guys know, and to really start promoting health and wellness. But those things combined with my extreme drive to make straight A's led to an eating disorder. And that's a pretty common story with girls trying to control the controllables in life, because there are certainly quite a few things that aren't controllable. And I didn't have a survival toolkit. I didn't know kind of how to survive and how to get through these kinds of things. So as I started thinking about high school and thinking about what Culture Relay, before it was in the world, what it was about, you know, I started thinking about if we could take sports and really make them for something good, really take it and make positivity in the world. And maybe if we could teach kids practical stuff, then they would also be so focused on an outside world that they wouldn't just spend time texting each other or Facebooking each other about things that didn't matter very much. So I started doing a lot of research, and I found out there are a few things that really help shape this mission. Girls are a whole lot less active than boys, particularly in this country and particularly in Alabama. And would you believe that 62% of girls would be considered not physically active in this country, which means 5 days or more, or 5 days or less of exercise a year? And that's so shocking for me as a marathon coach. I can't imagine that to be true, but it is. And it's important to understand this because sports participation has so much to do with people developing character. I mean, it's why you're here. It's probably why you're involved in sports and interested in them. And they also teach a lot of life skills that are pretty critical. So I got excited about this idea, really excited. But I've been in the for-profit world forever, so I had no idea how to create a nonprofit, a 501c3, and so I just started reaching out to a bunch of people and asking questions, and fortunately, a lot of people called me back. And I think there are probably three steps in all of our curriculum that we've put on. I think there are three steps that are probably great to talk about today. They are finding a goal, setting a goal, finding grit, developing stamina, and identifying your strengths. And so this is really core to anything that I teach in marathon running, and it's certainly core in business skill as well. So setting a goal, to tell you a story, I was in my second year of business school, and I had never run over 3 miles in my life. I'm not a long distance runner, I'm built like a sprinter, I sprinted in high school, I don't run long distance. And one of my friends in business school said to me, you know, if you can run 3 miles, you can run a full marathon. And I probably believe her now, but at the time I thought that was pretty crazy to think about. But honestly, I had packed all my classes first year in business school. I had packed them in so that I had a bunch of free time. And I thought, you know what, why not? I'll try. So this was in December of 1 year. And by April of that next year, 5 months later, I ran my first marathon, the Paris Marathon. And, you know, it's what I would call aggressive goal setting. I'm not certain that that's how every goal should be set. But I do think that that's a personal example for me of setting a goal and going for it. The second lesson is around developing stamina and finding grit. So there's no two ways about it. I don't know if I have, do I have any long distance runners in the room or any athletes? So, you know, running 18 miles in a training run, I mean, there's no two ways about it. It is really hard to do. It's hard, it's a slog, and you have to dig pretty deep, right? And there's no question that sometimes things are going to go wrong. When you're training for a race, there are multiple long distance runs that you have to do, and sometimes they're going to be easy and sometimes they're going to be terrible. And I think inner resilience is the key. And knowing how to find that inner grit just to keep going. I don't know if you guys have seen the video recently of the woman who crawled her way to the finish line. As a coach, it horrified me because I was so worried that that kind of damage is irreparable. But as a human being, watching a feat like that, watching someone claw their way to the end is pretty amazing. And so it gets easier with practice. Once you know you can get to an end of something, you can, and you will again and again. And so another story on finding my strengths, that's the third thing I'd like to talk about. And that's, I grew up as the anchor on our 4x100 track team in Birmingham at Homewood High School. And I was the anchor because I was really good at strategy, so I could figure out what we needed to do at the end of a race. And I was pretty quick, but I had really good baton passing skills, which is probably in some way where relay came from in culture relay. And so that's all well and good, but because I was helpful in winning several meets for our coach, he decided to put me in the mile relay. And you would think that anchoring a 4x1 is the same as anchoring a mile, but it's 4 times longer for me. And so as a sprinter, I was a disaster. I disappointed him horribly. He was watching from the stands. It was prom. I missed prom to run this track meet. And, you know, and I couldn't do it. He waited for my kick, and I never had a kick. I couldn't do it. And so, you know, I couldn't translate that to middle distance. But now in long distance, you know, I'm not the fastest marathoner. I never claim to be. But I stay away from injury. I run good races, and I can coach others to do it. So we're actually, Culture Relay is the partner of the New York Marathon. And so we have a charity team that runs for us in that race every year, which is pretty awesome. So now I've run a bunch of races. I've run Paris, Rotterdam, London, New York twice. And so I've taken something that I wasn't any good at, and now I coach others to do it. So this is a lot of running talk, and maybe everybody's not a runner in here, and that's fine. So let me translate this into other things for you. Last year, I joined a fellowship at Aspen Institute, and this is to challenge people to go from positions of leadership and places of success to places of significance. And what they're aiming to do is take people from the for-profit world and I think give them a conscience and move them forward into the non-for-profit world, or I would call it the for-purpose world. So I was working in my 18th year in corporate America, as I described, and I decided in my spare time I wanted to combine a few things. One is education. I absolutely love education. My mom's a professor. She was a professor at UAB for 30 years. I love teenage girls because they're hard, and it's such a difficult time in life, and everybody kind of gives up on that group of kids, I think, and I don't. Running, obviously, incredibly important to me. And the fourth thing is culture, because if you travel as much as I do, you get to see kids play sports all over the world. And I've seen soccer, for example, be the thing that put Israelis and Palestinians on the same field and playing together. So sport has an incredible power in this world, and I think it can actually create world peace. It's maybe ambitious, but I think we have to give it a shot. And so, you know, I thought I had reached all my goals. I got an MBA in French. I'm now in a boardroom in corporate America, but I felt empty inside. You know, it doesn't, you can reach these certain heights, and they don't, if they don't have purpose for you, then it doesn't matter. And so last year I decided to start Culture Relay. Andy did a great job describing what it is. It really is taking culture and teaching that around the world, and also it's a relay race. So we hand off in a global race from one set of girls to another. So it takes something that's an individual sport and it makes it a relay. So it's a lot of fun, and through that we get to teach job skills. So I think for you today, as you think about sport and what power it has, you know, there's so much, and whether you are interested in education and girls and all those things, it almost doesn't matter, because you can take sport and you can make it such a good, I think, environment for kids and for adults. So a funny thing, you know, I've talked about the success of Culture Relay, I guess, but I want to talk a little bit about the failures that I encountered at the beginning. Because I don't know, when I was sitting in your seat, I think I heard people talk about their successes, and I wish I had heard more about failure, because it's important to learn from it. So the first thing I did when I started Culture Relay was set my goal. And my goal was to create something that was a worldwide network of girls. But then I started to hit roadblocks, and I almost didn't know how to proceed. So last spring, I spent 4 of the hardest months of my life. You know, I didn't sleep much, because imagine I have a full-time job that probably takes 50, 60 hours a week. I'm doing Culture Relay at night until 2 or 3 in the morning, and I'm so driven by passion, because that's what happens when you get a hold of an idea, so driven by passion that I don't even take time. You know, certainly I didn't eat enough, so I lost a bunch of weight, and I definitely didn't even go to the bathroom as much as I, you know, as much as you might think you needed to, right? So it was like really a crazy time in life. And this is my baby, my heart and soul are in this. And so many people marveled at the speed in which I started this company. But right as we were about to launch, the craziest thing happened here in Birmingham. And it was a snowstorm. I mean, a snowstorm in Alabama. I grew up here, and exactly once it snowed in my entire life, until launch weekend of Culture Relay, and then it snowed like for a whole week. And so I had to try to explain to a bunch of Jordanians across the world that we were under snow, and they actually thought I was lying. They thought I was making it up, because we've never had snow before. And so the second challenge that happened during that period of time is I sent an email to my partner in Jordan, and you know, it was just totally lost in translation. I was using American business terms, and I said to them something about, I do what I say I'm going to do. And I meant to sound trustworthy. What they heard was that I was accusing them of not having done what they said they were going to do. And so probably, I mean, definitely in the Arab world, but probably anywhere, if you question the honor of someone, it's just not going to go well for you. And so needless to say, the email was, the response back was short and sharp, as you might expect. And I had managed to offend just about every major decision maker on that side of the world. So the irony is that I started a program to connect people and culture, and then I had just stumbled on the worst intercultural communication that you can imagine. So that actually led me to start studying, you know, what are these differences in communication? And, you know, there's high and low context culture. And what that means, you know, in America, we'll send emails, we'll do a lot of things that are, to them, impersonal. So they do a lot of video chat, and there's just a lot of different ways to establish trust around the world. And so I do think it's kind of funny that someone who purported to be, you know, heading up a cultural organization managed to really stumble in the first week. So faced with my personal project being completely derailed and months of work, not to mention all of my, you know, a lot of money of my own down the drain, I called a couple of entrepreneurs that I know pretty well. And I asked them, you know, is this just how it is to be an entrepreneur? And they said to me, you know, every moment of incredible jubilation is almost always followed by this deep despair. And so if you're going to be an entrepreneur, whether it's in the for-profit world or a social entrepreneur like I am now, you better get ready for it, because you're going to have hugely high things that happen, but you're also going to have these lows. And so that was helpful to hear from my friends, but they were guys, and I felt like I kind of needed like a woman hug at this point. So I called my friend Molly Barker. Molly founded an organization you guys may have heard of. It's called Girls on the Run. It's one of the most famous social entrepreneurship organizations in the world, and she's amazing. And she told me something pretty important, and she said every challenge that's a roadblock, or what she thought was a roadblock at the time, always led her to something bigger than she could have imagined. And that's pretty incredible that someone who has served 300,000 girls in this world at this point can admit that kind of thing. And what I didn't know at the time is she was also facing her huge challenge in her second big entrepreneurship launch. And because that, actually she never even launched. She was going through so many challenges at the same time I was forming Culture Relay that she ended up actually canning that. And she moved on into a different thing called the Red Boot Coalition, which is all about grassroots politics. And so her purpose had come from something that was nearly a failed launch, just like mine had been. So what did I do? I cut back our program to 6 weeks. I had to. We didn't have enough time. We were aiming at April 4th, which was the Dead Sea Marathon. We had to make that date, so we had to really make our timing shorter for the first launch. And I decided that launching with the wrong partner would teach, and in an international environment, would still teach me stuff I couldn't answer otherwise, right? So I didn't wait to get it 99% right. It was probably, I'm gonna go with 63% right, and I knew I would learn things like, does Skype work classroom to classroom? Can this even work, the technological piece of this? And are girls gonna actually sign up for this? Are they ever gonna do this? And so they did, and I learned a ton. Now, most importantly, that I've changed my idea of dancing with the one that brung me to choosing who I dance with. So now I've got a bunch of criteria on partnership that I use to decide who I want to partner with. But, you know, I think that's a really important lesson, you know, to learn as I go through this organization. And so grit then comes in, right? Grit's the stage where you begin to use those challenges as a refining factor. And it makes your idea or program so much stronger in order to really be able to turn water into wine, if you will. And so I don't really, I also think that grit is, in my opinion, is super good food here in the South. And girls raised in the South is also, grits are what we have here. But from the hard stuff, I moved on then into figuring out how to play to my strengths. And so I run strategy for an organization. I'm good at writing business plans. You know, instead of coming from, that's super helpful in building out a business. But what I realized is my strength is also my weakness. And that's a little bit what you saw in my TED Talk today. I'm actually practicing coming from my heart, because I, for 18 years, have come from my head in corporate America. And the combination of those two things is pretty powerful. And you cannot start an organization and get kids to follow you, or basically anyone to follow you, if you don't have passion for it and you don't believe in how to bring other people along. And so it's evolved into something I care a lot about, obviously. And you know, my favorite person, as I have been pressured to scale and to serve so many different constituencies, one of my favorite people on earth reminded me that I started this because I wanted to affect one person so much that they could go out and change the world. And so I'm gonna tell you that story, and then I'll close with a video. So Wyed. Wyed is originally from Jordan. She moved to Birmingham about 3 years ago, and she moved here because her mom got sick. And when they moved here for medical care. And then her brother got sick when she was here as well. So in some way, thankfully, they were here because they were able to get the medical care that they needed. She came to my first meeting on Culture Relay, and she doesn't speak fluent English. And she certainly has, she told me she would never ever run anything in her life, and she wasn't there to do it, so I shouldn't ask her to. She was just there to try to connect back to Jordan, because that was our first pilot program. And so, you know, if I had had a bunch of choices, I probably would have not chosen her to participate, but I had four kids show up, so Wade was in the first class. And then slowly but surely we got more kids to get involved. And you know what? She ended up being my best student by a long mile. It still makes me laugh that at 6:30 every Saturday I flew from New York to Birmingham to teach this course. And every morning she would show up at 6:45, and she just would breeze in and tell me that Arab time is 15 minutes later than you know American time, and that she was just going to be at 6:45. That's fine. And she also wore a full face of makeup, and she changed her hijab, her headscarf, probably every 2 hours, which was also pretty hysterical. She had never run long distance before. She never run any distance before, and had no confidence in it. But the really cool thing is, she went through the program. And she, you'll see her in the video, but she went through the program, and now she's running 5Ks all the time. And it makes me smile, because someone who told me they just definitely weren't going to do something, she ended up going on and doing it. She taught me the importance of unintended outcomes. So you can start something, and then along the way, you figure out what the real purpose of it all is. So I started this program internationally to try to connect around the world, and what I realized is, we have a whole lot of connection to do right here in our own town, right? In every town. And so in this spring, we're actually working in Birmingham City Schools and Mountain Brook. So we're Woodlawn and Mountain Brook, two pretty different schools, if you guys are familiar with Birmingham schools. And we're connecting them to Chile, to Belize, to Kenya, et cetera. So a lot of different kinds of schools. But you know, I would have never really thought about how much communication we needed just right here in our own city. So it's made me start thinking about whether it needs to be international at all. Maybe it's a domestic model. And I think it's pretty interesting to have found that and be flexible in that, except for runners just aren't flexible. So the only thing I'm flexible in is figuring out how to change path. So that's really it. And I wanted to finish with a video of our girls, because you know now I'm starting to step off the stage and I'm putting them forward, because I do think that they are the ones that are teaching me so much. So often in life, the teacher ends up being the student. And I will play that for you, and then I'll open it up for questions. Oh, there's an issue with playback. Andy! Oh, let's see.
Hello, I'm 50 years old. I'm Nihan Sinsenet. I'm working as a dermatologist. I'm an assistant director in a summer camp in New Mexico.
The student Victoria Sagunas
Tantibu. I'm a pastry chef and have my own bakery.
I'm a high fashion designer and an activist.
As I look back on my life,
I realize that to get to where I am today,
I had to stay focused and dedicate my hard work and time to the things that I'm passionate about.
Have a clear goal and work towards it every day.
And my perseverance will repay off.
If I could tell my younger self one piece of advice,
know your worth and don't compare yourself to others.
Some things in life have come hard to me, such as school.
It's not the end of the world.
Nothing that happened in high school matters in the real world.
I knew I was capable of more than I could imagine when I ran my first 5K.
When I completed a half marathon.
When I completed the culture relayed 5K without stopping at all.
When I moved to the USA and left all my friends and loved ones behind.
Culture relay told me that I can achieve anything that I set my mind to.
I'm more capable of things than I really imagined.
Culture relay taught me that I am strong.
Culture relay helped me to get to where I am today because I was able to grow in a diverse community using technology to learn about other cultures.
I developed a strong network of friends.
And I loved that we got to talk with girls from around the world.
Because
culture is even how you say hello.
Culture relay taught me that I'm a lot stronger than I think I am, and I don't give up easily.
I can do things that I have never done before.
Thanks.